Wow, I have goosebumps. Thanks to Philip Swan, Stephen Seek, and the Welcome Week Choir. They're amazing. Well done. Good morning. My name is Beth Sinsley. As chair of the Public Events Committee, I have two tasks to perform from the chapel stage today. The first is to announce this year's convocation series and, more directly, to encourage you all to attend. So, here we go. On October 23rd, a mere 2 weeks before the midterm elections, we will host political scientist Catherine Kramer. Her talk, entitled Listening Well in a World That Turns Away, will build on her innovative research into public opinion and contemporary politics, which was presented most recently in her award-winning book, The Politics of Resentment, Rural Consciousness in Wisconsin, and the Rise of Scott Walker. Listening well, what a radical therapy for political division. Truly, the timing of Dr. Kramer's convocation could not be more perfect. On January 17th, astronomer Phil Plait will deliver a lecture entitled Strange New Worlds. Is Earth special? In his popular science blog, Bad Astronomy, Dr. Plait endeavors to challenge socially accepted ignorance about science with wry humor, but also with urgency. In 2002, he wrote, quote, "It isn't okay. In fact, it's dangerous to be ignorant about science." If anything, this dangerous ignorance about science is even more pervasive and acute today. So come and learn something new about Earth during Dr. Plait's convocation. This spring, Indigenous artist Matika Wilbur will give a talk titled Changing the Way We See Native America. And she will also quite literally do just that. Wilbur, in addition to her convocation address, Wilbur, who's a member of the Swinomish and Tulalip peoples, will work with Indigenous students to conceptualize, design, and install large-scale wheat paste murals on campus. You will see the murals going up the week of her talk, and I know they will inspire you to come on April 11th to hear her speak. To complete our convocation series this year, Dr. David Burrows has been selected to receive Lawrence's Faculty Convocation Award. Dave, a professor of psychology and the director of inclusive pedagogy, will present a talk on education for effective action at the Honors Convocation on May 22nd. His modest proposal, to build a new conception of liberal learning for the 21st century, will also include examples of how this idea might impact the liberal arts curriculum here at Lawrence. And I'm really looking forward to hearing Dave speak on this topic. My second task is to introduce today's matriculation convocation speaker, President Mark Burstein. Rumor has it that our 16th president does not care for extended introductions, and many of us already know the highlights of his career at prior institutions. Going on 6 years at Lawrence, I thought it might be a good time to reflect briefly on one emblematic moment of Mark's tenure here, one that was particularly meaningful to me, and what that moment tells us about his values and intentions. In October of 2013, Mark proposed reinstalling Rolf Westphal's public sculpture, Aerial Landscape, in its original location on the west side of the Riston Art Center. The work is also known by a few nicknames on campus, the Golden Arches, the upside-down LUs, among others. With help from the artist and several different campus and community constituencies, the sculpture was repaired, repainted, and rededicated in April 2014. Despite my own affection for it, I'm aware that Aerial Landscape is not everyone's favorite work of public art. But the point, of course, was not to install a sculpture that everyone would immediately agree on. Pleasing everyone with public art is an impossible task in any case. Just ask my studio art colleague, Rob Nielsen. Rather, the purpose of this project was to restore something that fostered a sense of community and history on our campus. In a similar fashion, Mark does not present his convocation address as something everyone will immediately agree on, nor does he want it to be. Rather, he considers this to be the start of a conversation we should be having as a community. He values your feedback on his address, and he encourages you to contact him with your thoughts following his talk today. And that's mark.burstein@lawrence.edu. So let's start a conversation. Please welcome President Mark Burstein to discuss an even larger work of public art in his matriculation convocation address, standing with the Statue of Liberty.
It's really a pleasure to see you all here today. Beth, thank you for your leadership of the Public Events Committee this year, and also for that really very nice introduction. Thank you, Catherine Hanford, for providing an organ prelude that sets the stage for this and all our convocations. Thank you, Philip Swan, Stephen Seek, and members of the entering class for beginning our year with such beauty. I look forward to many future performances. And thank you, Linda Morgan Clement, for providing closing words for today's convocation. I also want to thank the many members of the Lawrence community who helped me with research for today's talk. I am grateful to David McGlynn and the Public Events Committee of last year for assembling a provocative and engaging convocation series for us to enjoy. I hope you will join me in attending them. I want to specifically mention our convocation with Matika Wilbur, which Beth mentioned earlier, on April 11th. Matika will be with us to discuss changing the way we see Native America. Her talk will be part of a larger effort to renew our connections with Native American communities, both in Wisconsin and around the country. Welcome to the academic year. I want to specifically welcome our 425 first-year transfer and visiting students, 8 new tenure-line faculty, and many other new faculty and staff. I know you will join me in extending a warm Lawrence welcome to all new members of our community. Preparing for a matriculation convocation provides a moment to look back at the previous year to see what we as a community need to discuss. For the first time in the 6 years that I've had the privilege of addressing you, an overwhelming number of issues rose to the surface. Extreme weather and resulting emergencies such as forest fires, drought, and hurricanes filled the news cycle. We learned more deeply about the effects of electronic interconnectedness and the open door social media provided to foreign influence in many democracies. The Me Too movement woke the nation to the corrosive impact of a toxic blend of power, gender, and sexual assault. Especially concerning for those of us in the academy, we were reminded that this trend continues on college campuses as well as in larger society. Many voices have mounted a direct attack on the value of facts and evidence-based research, concepts that lie at the heart of the education that we offer. And communities around the world continue to struggle to connect across differences of race, religion, political views, ethnicity, gender, and socioeconomic class. The education provided by Lawrence and other institutions of higher learning has never been more needed. I look forward to discussing and debating these themes and many others, both inside our classrooms and on campus this year. But in the end, for me, the most searing image of last year were the pictures of young, terrified children in deep pain as they were taken from their parents at the border. These pictures represented over 2,300 children separated due to a new zero-tolerance policy instituted on the southwest border, a policy that ushered in the next stage of our country's changing attitudes towards immigration. These images, as well as images of refugees risking their lives in forced march and sea travel in decrepit boats, rafts, and dinghies, filled our consciousness this past year. They have brought to a boil in the United States and around the world the issue of immigration, refugee resettlement, and the growing number of displaced persons. The numbers alone are shocking. According to a 2017 report by the UN Refugee Agency, at least 68.5 million people are now forcibly displaced from their homes due to political strife, environmental degradation, and other calamities. This is larger than the population of the United Kingdom. Over half of these displaced persons are younger than 18. The trend line is also concerning. The number of displaced persons has grown by 60% in 10 years. In 2017, 16.2 million people were displaced from their homes, three times the population of the state of Wisconsin. From the public conversation, one may assume that most of these displaced persons have now moved to Europe and North America. Actually, the vast majority, more than four out of every five of these displaced persons, reside in countries adjacent to their homelands. Turkey hosts the largest number. Pakistan, Uganda, Lebanon, and Iran round out the top five host countries. Growing destinations include Bangladesh, which received over 500,000 refugees from Myanmar in a six-month period, and Colombia, which has become the destination of close to 500,000 refugees from Venezuela. After visiting a Syrian refugee camp in Jordan, Khaled Hosani, author of The Kite Runner, said, "These are important numbers, but it is a hard thing to picture millions of faces all at once. Numbers have a way of making them merge, turning them into a blur of human tragedy, a calamity so sprawling that it undermines our ability to truly see it." Recent authors such as Leila Albizerg, Alexander Hamon, Dave Eggers, and Hosani himself have tried in their writings to humanize, to allow us to feel as we are imagining the moving and desperate plight of displaced persons. Given that there are fewer than 6 million Native Americans, Native Hawaiians, and Native Alaskans in a country of 325 million, America is a country populated almost entirely from elsewhere. Many of us remember our family's immigration narrative. Some of our stories include the choice to immigrate. Others tell of displacement from homelands by expulsion, force, or enslavement. The popularity of companies such as Ancestry.com and 23andMe underscores our growing interest in these stories. My husband David's and my family origins illustrate some of the different choices that led people to become citizens of this country. My grandparents on one side of my family and great-grandparents on the other side fled economic and religious persecution in Eastern Europe at the turn of the 20th century. They came here as uneducated refugees, unaccompanied minors with no skills or resources. To survive, they built small family businesses like the Irish and Italian immigrants who surrounded them in the New York metropolitan area. They also practiced what some now call chain migration, frantically trying to bring family members to the United States before what turned out to be certain murder by Nazi Germany. My in-laws immigrated to the United States in the 1950s from Colombia, South America. Because they were highly educated, a doctor and a nurse, our government actively recruited them to this country. When my father-in-law went to the U.S. consulate in Medellin, the official asked him what visa he wanted. When he responded he didn't really know, the official suggested a green card would be the best option because it gave him the most flexibility. He finished a postdoctoral fellowship at Duke and began to practice pathology at the University of Chicago. My family successfully fled persecution and likely death. David's family experienced both economic opportunity and prejudice for the first time here in the United States as a Spanish-speaking family marooned in a wider white English-speaking society. I am sure family narratives in this room range even more widely than David's and mine. Some of us lived on this land and we were forced to migrate to reservations. Others affirmatively decided to immigrate for a better life. Or we were kidnapped into slavery, or fled persecution, economic hardship, and imminent death. Can we take our personal narratives and develop a policy perspective from them? Last year, I suggested three possible core values for us as a community: to teach emotional intelligence and practice empathy, to reinforce our commitment to academic freedom and freedom of speech with limits, and to ensure equity in all that we do. I want to thank the many of you who contacted me afterwards to discuss and debate this list. If we agree that practicing empathy and pursuing equity are core values for our community, then perhaps we can learn to see parallels to our own family's narratives with the experience of people fleeing economic hardship and political persecution around the globe today. The impulse to support the stranger in our land is reinforced for many of us by our religious beliefs. For example, Leviticus in the Hebrew Bible states, "When a foreigner resides among you in your land, do not mistreat them. The foreigner residing among you must be treated as your native born. Love them as yourself, for you were foreigners in Egypt." Galatians from the New Testament states, "The entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one commandment, love your neighbor as yourself." From the Buddhist perspective, the way of the Bodhisattva states, "Since I and other beings both in fleeing suffering are equal and alike, what difference is there to distinguish us that I should save myself and not the others?" But our history suggests that we as a nation have struggled from the beginning to learn from our personal past and from these teachings. And here in the United States, the past 15 years of political conflict over immigration policy simply recapitulate this long struggle. This is particularly true for people who want to join us and who represent religions, races, or ethnicities different from the majority of citizens already here. Many scholars point to Roger Williams and the establishment of the colony of Rhode Island and the Providence plantations in 1636 as the beginning of our debate about this country's constraints on immigration and citizenship. Williams, an early immigrant to the Massachusetts Bay Colony from England, believed in religious freedom and the separation of church and state. This philosophical stance did not sit well with the Puritan leadership of Massachusetts. In response, he founded a new colony, despite the objection of the Puritan leadership, that welcomed people of all religions, including Baptists, Jews, and Quakers. He established a close connection with the Narragansett tribe, and he pursued anti-slavery policies. Thus began one of the first debates of who can truly be an American citizen. In A Nation by Design, Aristide Zolberg chronicles the long internal struggle to define American immigration policy. He writes, "This country's policy from the drafting of the Declaration of Independence into the 20th century has been influenced by the amount of land available for development, by national economic conditions, including the demand for labor, and by racial, ethnic, and religious considerations. State and federal legislators alternatively enacted and relaxed restrictive policies throughout the early 1920s. This period of general welcome allowed millions of new citizens to immigrate to the United States, including many who made their home here in Wisconsin. What seemed particularly salient to me as I thought about what is happening today is the period from the end of the First World War into the late 1920s, when the United States government decided to significantly curtail immigration. In that period, we directly restricted non-Anglo-Saxon peoples. Right after the war, books like The Passing of the Great Race by Madison Grant, the chairman of the New York Zoological Society and a trustee of the American Museum of Natural History, and The Rising Tide of Color Against the White World Supremacy by Lothrop Stoddard, encouraged a belief in white racial supremacy. The Ku Klux Klan, which targeted African Americans, foreigners, Catholics, and Jews, also saw a resurgence of membership and activity during this period. Some people spoke out against this trend. For example, the New York Times proclaimed in an editorial, "This new historic idea of racial determinism runs counter to our spiritual convictions as to the brotherhood of all human beings and the identical precociousness of all human souls." But the insistence on white racial supremacy remained powerful in the country and in the political process. What followed was a series of laws that imposed a drastic restriction on immigration to the United States, including the requirement of a literacy test, the direct barring of immigrants from Asia and Mexico, and quotas for individual European countries based on the number of U.S. citizens who had already come from that country. These laws specifically curtailed immigration of Italians, Mexicans, Jews, Japanese, and Chinese. As James Davis, Secretary of Labor, asserted in 1923 in the idiom of his time, "We want the beaver type of man. We want to keep out the rat type." Concerns about security, national demographics, and economic health led presidential administrations and congressional majorities from both parties to sustain these policies through the early 1960s. Even the severe persecution of Jews and other communities by Nazi Germany and the uprooting of millions of people in the wake of the Second World War did not lead to major changes in our policies. As Breckinridge Long, a senior member of the State Department in the Roosevelt administration, confided to his diary after a conversation with another colleague, he says they are lawless, scheming, defiant, and in many ways, unassimilable. He said the general type of an intending immigrant was just the same as the criminal Jews who crowd our police court dockets in New York and with whom he is acquainted. He goes on in his diary, "I think he is right, not as regards the Russian and Polish Jew alone, but the lower level of all that Slav population of Eastern Europe and Western Asia." Exceptions were approved by Congress for refugees after the war, but the quota system remained in place. These laws were reaffirmed in 1952 by Act of Congress over the veto of President Truman, who called the legislation a slur on the patriotism, the capacity, and the decency of a large part of our citizenry. In 1965, legislation passed and signed into law at the Statue of Liberty by President Johnson eliminated the quotas, prioritized family reunification, and opened up immigration from Asia, Mexico, and Africa. This new policy lived up to the words of the poem inscribed on the base of the Statue of Liberty by Emma Lazarus. Give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free, the wretched refuse of your teeming shore. Send these, the homeless, tempest-tossed, to me. This significant change in national policy also set up the present debates on immigration and the future of our country. Many of the arguments deployed during these legislative battles continue to be alive today. For example, we hear that immigrants commit more crimes than U.S. citizens, a similar argument to ones made in the 1920s. But in an article in USA Today 3 weeks ago, Alan Gomez reviewed data from a number of different sources that uniformly point to a lower crime and incarceration rate for immigrants than for U.S. citizens. Moreover, multiple studies find that immigration and even specifically refugee resettlement increases economic activity. Immigrants actually have a positive impact on wages in the country. On average, they have more advanced degrees than U.S. citizens. They start new businesses and file patents at a higher rates than U.S.-born citizens. Taxes paid by immigrants and their children here, both legally and illegally, exceed the cost of services they use. So why is the United States headed back to policies first put forward in the 1920s? In social identity theory and public opinion towards immigration, published earlier this year by Maurice Mangum and Ray Block Jr., suggest there are two reasons for citizens of this country to oppose immigration in all forms. Americans generally oppose immigration if they believe immigrants will not adhere to American norms, prompting cultural change. And they believe they are competing with immigrants for their economic well-being. Thus, Laura Ingraham's statement last month on Fox News that in some parts of the country, it does seem like the America we know and love doesn't exist anymore. Massive demographic changes have been foisted on the American people. They're changes none of us ever voted for and most of us don't like. From Virginia to California, we see stark examples of how radically, in some ways, the country has changed. Much of this is related to both illegal and, in some cases, legal immigration. Such pronouncements, informed by opinion, not data, directly fan the flames of resentment felt by many. There have been other, very different examples around the world in response to the refugee crisis. Angela Merkel, Chancellor of Germany, clearly took a different path with her decision to welcome 1 million refugees in 2015. Many tie this decision to her research, which included a book by Jorgen Osterheimel entitled The Transformation of the World. This book argues that most successful 19th century economies championed open markets and liberal immigration laws. Among other benefits, these policies spurred technological advances. Her decision was also personal. As she said at an EU summit in characteristically very few words, I once lived behind a fence. That is something I do not wish to do again. Merkel's comments were echoed 4 weeks ago in the late Senator John McCain's final letter to the American people. He said, We weaken our greatness when we confuse our patriotism with tribal rivalries that have sown resentment and hatred and violence in all the corners of the globe. We weaken it when we hide behind walls rather than tear them down, when we doubt the power of our ideals rather than trust them to be the great force of change that they have always been. Knowing our past struggles and seeing our current situation, how can we, as individuals and as a community, stand with the Statue of Liberty? The university has taken steps in this direction. We joined 39 other institutions in signing Friend of the Court briefs for two lawsuits against the current administration's decision to overturn the Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals Program, or DACA. These cases have been successful at the federal appeals court level, which has so far prevented the discontinuation of this policy. We have also worked with our students, faculty, and staff to ensure that everything has been done to protect our community and to qualify citizenship and immigration status. We have reached out to recent immigrants in the Fox Valley to offer employment. But we must do more as individuals and as a community to ensure that at this critical juncture for the United States and other nations around the globe, that we do not return to the policies of the 1920s, that we do not restrict immigration to this country out of imagined political, economic, and racial fears. Even locally, immigrant communities which have been hosted and nurtured by our neighbors in the Fox Cities need our support and friendship. There are thousands of immigrants and refugees in our midst, here and close to 70 million people around the globe, counting on our leadership. This work connects to our own institutional values, but also to this nation's highest ambition for itself. As the Statue of Liberty's inscription and symbol reminds us, we are a nation of natives and immigrants. We must stand for these values today and always. Again, I look forward to hearing your reactions, disagreements, and responses to my words today. Good luck in this new academic year. It is an absolute pleasure to have you all back here in Appleton. Thank you.
Thank you, President Burstein, for your considered challenge to all of us. Friends, in light of this address, I invite us to take a moment to recognize who shares this space. There are people, friends and strangers, some new to Lawrence and some long accustomed. There are stories, spoken and hidden in each of us, accomplishments and failures, love, anger, shame, and generosity. There is the more than human, the oxygen, hydrogen, carbon, bacteria, viruses, spiders, metals, fibers, and soil. We bring our history, the ancestors who dwell in our DNA, the first peoples who have called this place home, the ocean and the bedrock that have danced from the first. There is stardust, stardust at the heart of all that is, In the midst of all this chorus of life, know that your life is consequential and deeply interconnected. I would like to close our convocation with a poem entitled, Things We Carry on the Sea, Wang Ping, 1957. We carry tears in our eyes. Goodbye, father. Goodbye, mother. We carry soil in small bags. May home never fade in our hearts. We carry names, stories, memories of our fields, boats, and villages. We carry scars from proxy wars of greed. We carry carnage of mining, droughts, floods, genocides. We carry the dust of our families and neighbors incinerated in mushroom clouds. We carry our islands sinking under the sea. We carry our hands, feet, bones, hearts, and best minds for a new life. We carry diplomas, medicine, engineer, nurse, education, math, poetry, even if they mean nothing on the other shore. We carry railroads, plantations, laundromats, bogas, taco trucks, farms, factories, nursing homes, hospitals, schools, temples, built on our ancestors' backs. We carry old homes along the spine, new dreams in our chests. We carry yesterday, today, tomorrow. We're orphans of the wars forced upon us. We're refugees of the seas from rising industrial waste. And we carry our mother tongues, Ai, Lieb, Amour, Love, Ping, Salam, Salom, Shalom, Paz, Peace. Esperanza, hope, hope, hope. As we drift in our rubber boats from shore to shore to shore.